Well, good morning, everyone. This is Chris Duffey. I'm the principal engineer at EasyPower, and today's webinar will be on applying the IEEE 519 harmonic standard. And this is a topic that I'm pretty familiar with, and let's get started. The 519 standard, which was updated in 1992, presently is the authority document within the United States on harmonic limits. And it's been entitled IEEE Recommended Practices and Requirements for Harmonic Control in Electrical Power Systems. Now, interesting, the titling, Recommended Practices and Requirements, places the 519 standard just one notch below an actual ANSI IEEE standard, such as C37.010 for breakers. And so it doesn't quite carry the full weight of an ANSI IEEE standard, but because it's a recommended practice, we really need to pay attention to it and make sure that we're following the guidelines in the standard within our facilities so that distortion levels throughout the electrical power system are going to be within acceptable levels. And what's needed most in any standard is having a clear understanding of its scope and application, and we're going to talk about that. The IEEE 519 is no different. And it in no way covers every harmonics-related area that's at issue within a facility or out on the utility grid, but it does offer a method for controlling harmonic distortion within power systems where it disperses the burden of control or mitigation in a reasonable and logical manner. So let's consider five topics today. Let's look at the scope, and really that should say scope and application. I didn't fix that on my slides. That would make it correspond exactly with the IEEE 519 standard, and I have a copy here. It would be good to have a copy of the standard, I would say, if you want to refer to it, so you can hear me flipping through the pages. And if you go to Chapter 1, Section 1.2 and 1.3 talks about scope and application. So we're going to look at that briefly. The basis for harmonic current limits, that is, how did they come about? Low voltage distortion limits due to notching, current distortion limits, and voltage distortion limits for utilities. Now, the 1992 update improved on the 1981 predecessor by including current distortion limits, more defined voltage distortion limits, and a more clearly defined application procedure. So we establish goals now for the design of systems with linear and nonlinear loads. That's one of the clear goals that we wanted to have, and that is we wanted to be able to not only perform harmonic distortion calculations, but we wanted to do measurements in the system that were a combination of linear and nonlinear loads. And obviously, we all know that the nonlinear load is what creates the distortion condition. The interface between sources and loads are described in the standard as the point of common coupling. And that one term, boy, you know, it carries so much with it. There was so much discussion around that term in the day. And I don't know if you remember in the day when harmonics were going on. And I noticed on the seminar that Ray Crow is on here. And thanks, Ray, for being here. And Ray is really into arc flash. And everyone knows that arc flash is a really key item of discussion right now, and application and limits that are being set so that you can look at arc flash hazard, okay? So, but that's the big thing going on right now, and it's really important. Let's not really call it a fad, okay? Even though we could say there was the harmonics fad, and actually before harmonics, you know, there was a distribution feeder arcing fault fad, okay? If you can go that far back and know that one. So we had the harmonics fad, then came the power quality fad, then came, well, now we're kind of into the arc flash. But if we call it a fad, what we're doing is we're saying, well, once it's over, we forget about it. And that's what we just cannot do. Arc flash is real important to understand right now, and it's really good that it's being brought to the forefront so that we can all be educated and note the serious about it. But you know, that is the exact same thing that happened with harmonics and power quality. But unfortunately, we kind of have left it in the rear view mirror, and we've kind of walked away from it. And we just can't do that. We have to remember the education of the time, because harmonics have not gone away. Those kind of problems are actually becoming more numerous now because people kind of forgot about them for a while, but they never went away. The amount of drives being applied on systems is going up. Just one thing after the other is going to cause these problems to be there, and we have to make sure we address them. So the limits address for us with harmonics, for this knowledge that we want to remember, steady state, worst case conditions. It does not consider transient conditions that can actually exceed the limits. And there's another slide later on that we'll look at about how much they can be exceeded. And it does not cover radio frequency interference. All right, so here we go. In my opinion, the most important aspect of the standard is to understand its application as a system standard and not as an equipment standard. Really, really key item. I can still remember Ray Stratford. You know, I worked for Ray Stratford back at PTI, and if you look in the document, you'll see Ray Stratford was one of the chair people on there. I can really remember this being hit. This is not an equipment standard. We are not doing this. Now, IEC has equipment standards, but that's not what the IEEE 519 harmonic standard was created for. And we'll see that in a few more slides here, right out of the text, okay? It's a system standard, and it really shouldn't be applied as equipment standard. And unfortunately, you will see some drive manufacturers saying they, quote, meet IEEE 519. That is really not a correct statement. You may try to use current limits in the standard, you know, to help you say that you meet, quote, the 519 limits, but that's not the actual scope and application of the standard. The standard clearly notes that if the harmonic limits are supplied for application to consumers of electrical power and to suppliers of electrical power at a location called the point of common coupling. Let's do some reading right out of the standard. The recommendation described in this document attempts to reduce the harmonic effects at any point in the entire system by establishing limits on certain harmonic indices, that is, currents and voltages, at the point of common coupling, a point of metering, or any point, as long as both the utility and the consumer can either access the point for direct measurement of the harmonic indices that are meaningful to both, or can estimate those indices at the point of interference through mutually agreeable methods. Within an industrial plant, the PCC is the point between the nonlinear load and other loads. Now, please listen to me on this and just bear with me on my understanding of this. Within an industrial plant, that one statement has caused so much confusion and so much, in my eyes, misapplication of the standard. You cannot read that statement and ignore the above portion. Okay, you just can't pull that out of the standard and read it without having the context of, as both the utility and the consumer. Remember, up above, the utility and the consumer. The 519 was written as a system standard at the point of common coupling between suppliers of electrical energy and consumers. You can apply it on the inside of your plant if you want to. I mean, that's not its intended purpose, however. Intended purpose was to keep voltage distortion on the utility grid under control by controlling the amount of current injections that were coming from consumers of electrical power. So that's my, I've talked with people like Conrad St. Pierre, I've talked to a number of people out in the industry, and we all agree on this, that's the original, the main intention of the standard. So I know that statement is in there, and I have seen it misused over and over again. But again, that's not the scope within the scope and application of the IEEE 519. Continuing, this recommended practice recognizes the responsibility that users have not to degrade the voltage of the utility serving other users by requiring nonlinear currents from the utility. You basically require those injections from the utility if you're creating them inside your facility. Okay? So they have to be served from someplace, and if you don't have any filtration in your facility, I'll guarantee you the harmonics will be flowing out to the utility. So you're requiring that they absorb that. It also recognizes the responsibility of the utilities to provide users with close to a sine wave of voltage. The recommended practice suggests guidelines for accomplishing this. So what limits really are actually supplied in the standard? First, you'll come across the low voltage limits. And they are written in terms of two items, voltage notching and THD in a facility. Now, this is 0 up to 1 kV, basically. That's what we consider low voltage to be. And there's just three THD numbers, and I have a table on that, and we'll look at that. And there's also some numbers for voltage notching that are defined by area and depth, I believe. Or maybe it's just notch area. Anyways, we'll see the table. It'll become real clear there. Also supplied in the standard, current distortion limits for consumers. For who? Not a drive. No, not a feeder. Current distortion limits supplied for consumers of electrical power. Voltage distortion limits are supplied for suppliers of electrical power. Note, there's a flicker curve. There's TIF table, there's an IT table, TIF and IT product. These tables are not limits. Please understand, read the title of the figures. I mean, I could turn to the page right now. TIF and IT are typical. Read the title of the table. And if you look at Flickr, it says in the paragraph above it, it says these are just guidelines. These are not parts of the 519 that are meant to be limits. Okay? Be careful with those, because I've seen those items quoted, especially I've seen TIF and IT quoted as a limit that has to be met. And I'll guarantee you there's enough hand-waving and stuff going on with calculation of TIF and IT where there's no guarantee those numbers are even realistic, okay, based on the arrangement of conductors and how far they might be from a communication cable or something. Continuing, harmonic current limits were created with a basis now. So if we want to look at how were these created, what was the real basis for everything, the ground floor, they were created with a tight link to voltage distortion. And according to the standard, here's what it says. The philosophy of developing harmonic limits in this recommended practice is to limit the harmonic injection from individual customers so that they will not cause unacceptable what? Voltage distortion levels. So everything falls back to voltage distortion, okay? It all does. The current limits were created so that voltage distortion on a utility system would be minimized and kept under control. Limit the overall harmonic distortion on the system voltage supplied by the utility. The second statement there. That's our basis. So the current limits supplied in the standard assume a typical system characterized by a simple short circuit impedance. In other words, there's no resonances on the system. Simple short circuit impedance. Limit the maximum individual voltage distortion to 3%. Okay. Limit the total voltage THD to 5%. So that means the maximum 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, whatever harmonic cannot go above 3% voltage distortion. And the total voltage THD, which is the square root of the sum of the squares of each of the individual harmonic components, is limited to 5%. Assume that there will be some diversity. Okay, now this is kind of a gray area. I did a lot of work on this in the past, and how the diversity was supplied. I know there's a table we're going to look at here in just a second. it still was not very clear to me. And I tried to recreate the limits in the standard from what was the information that's supplied in the basis, and I really could not get there. And I have some other ideas on how they came up with those numbers, but it's not necessarily clearly spelled out. But again, the whole philosophy was 3% individual, 5% total THD. So here's the table in the basis section. And you can see here that the short circuit versus the load strength here, in other words, this is how strong is your system versus how big are you. That's how this table is shown. It increases with the short circuit ratio. This is the maximum individual harmonic that could be in terms of percent. And this is the assumption. And we have increasing diversity as we drop down through the table. Again, I'm not going to get into real detail on this table. Just know it has. I've looked at it in detail at times past. So let's look at our first set of limits that are supplied in the IEEE 519, and that's in Table 13. And we see three rows. So I was correct. Notch area, notch depth, and then the row on THD for voltage distortion. So under special applications like hospitals, airports, things where we have real critical infrastructure, they recommend no higher than 3%. And this is where you get that 5% number. If you've ever heard people say, hey, you know, I recommend you don't go above 5% THD, this is where it comes from. So in this table, we say don't go above, for general systems, don't go above 5% voltage THD. But for a dedicated system, which would be like a dedicated transformer feeding a drive bus where there's nothing but adjustable speed drives, you can exceed the 5%, go up to 10% on such a dedicated system. If it were me personally, I'd validate that that's correct with the drive vendor. I'd make sure it's true. Also, in my experience, I have used the 5% number also for medium voltage systems with great success. And what I have discovered is that if you perform filtration or if you mitigate a harmonic issue in a system and you get it at 5% or below, basically everything just starts working. I've seen a case. I applied harmonic filters for a client, and their distortion was up around 8, 9, 10% at times. It would go up and down. When we applied the harmonic filtration and the voltage distortion peaked out around, you know, 4.5 or 4.7%, things started working that were like glitching and rebooting all the time. All of a sudden, the problems went away. So I think the 5% voltage THD applied to low voltage and medium voltage is an excellent figure of merit to use in your designs. Okay, so we've looked at the voltage distortion limits. If you want to know how to calculate the notch depth and notch area, you can do it off this figure that is right in the IEEE 519 standard. Now, realize that in reality, there's going to be significant ringing on each one of these glitches here where you dip down and you go back up. And so you have to, by eye, estimate what this is in a lot of instances. And, of course, this assumes that you've captured a waveform with adequate sample speed so that you can measure the actual notch depth and area, okay? So you have to have a good set of instrumentation for capturing a waveform like this. Let's go to our current distortion limits. This is like the big one, okay? The standard states in section 10 of the recommended practice. It says, this section describes the current distortion limits that apply to individual consumers of electrical energy. All right, come on, let's read that again. Limits that apply to individual consumers of electrical energy. So you can tell that this is written for like plants, for buildings, for things where there is an interface, there is like a metering, something is happening, and there's an exchange between a utility and a consumer. Now section 11, by the way, this is written in section 10. It's referencing section 11. Section 11 describes the quality of electrical power that the producer should furnish to the consumer. These limitations are for the benefit of all parties involved. This recommendation supersedes 81 and focuses on the PCC with the consumer utility interface. Please, I know some people might get upset that I'm pushing this so hard, but this is what the standard says. And I can remember being there, you know, when the documents, when we sent the documents, and this was the entire intention of the 519 standard. It was not necessarily, it wasn't meant to be applied on the inside of a facility. Now, you can use it that way if you'd like to, and it may happen, Stance, that it helps you. That's great, but that was not the intention or, you know, the scope of our application of the standard. So when applying the current limits, the provided limits, when applying the provided limits, the recommended current distortion limits are concerned with the following indice. Now, I know I've been reading a lot right out of the standard, but I just think this is so important for us. Just read it, write what it says, okay? We're concerned with this, total demand distortion. In other words, we have to put our current distortion, if we're going to have a limit in a table, we have to put it on a single basis, not on just fundamental current, because that goes up and down. So we have to do it off of a single basis, and we're going to call that total demand distortion, where the harmonic distortion is in percent of the maximum demand load current. That's a 15 or 30 minute maximum demand over the preceding 12 months, depending on how you're metered, 15 minute metering or 30 minute metering over the preceding 12 months. So we want a maximum level. Okay, the limits in 10, 3, 4, and 5 should be used as system design values for the worst case for normal operation. Worst case of normal operation. Now, if we have conditions, you know, where we have unusual conditions from startups or some type of a transition period, something that's not the normal operation, the limits may be exceeded by 50%. So this is your loophole right here for odd conditions, startup, plant shutdowns, and you're bringing things back up, and you exceed the 519 by up to 50% above the limits. You can, it's specified here that that is a legal thing to do for you. But again, overall, we want conditions lasting longer than 1 hour, all right, for normal operation. Now, this is a really interesting part about the current distortion limits. I can remember sitting down with an engineer by the name of Alan Ludbrook and then Ray Stratford, who was one of the chairmen of the committee. And basically, Alan was noticing that when he applied the limits, that if you had a large multi-pulse rectifier installation, you'd violate them. You'd violate the limits. You'd have a voltage distortion extremely low, I mean well below a percent up on the 230 kV, okay? But the rectifier installation would be in violation of the limits. And so to cover for that condition where voltage distortion is way reduced because of a multipulse installation, he came up with, and this is Alan Ludbrook's concept and idea, and it was put in the standard, of the increasing the limits equal to a factor of the square root of Q over 6. So let's read it. These tables are applicable to 6-pulse rectifiers and general distortion situations. However, when phase shift transformers or converters with pulse numbers higher than 6 are used, the limits for the characteristic harmonic orders are increased by a factor equal to square root of Q over 6, provided that the amplitudes of the non-characteristic harmonic orders are less than 25% of the limit specified in the table. So if you have a 12-pulse rectifier system, okay, the whole concept, the whole idea is that 11 and 13 can be increased by square root of Q over 6, and 5 and 7, their limit is 25% of what's in the table. Okay, can you see what I did there? The non-characteristic harmonic orders of a 12-pulse system are 5, 7, see, then you go 11, 13, 17, and 19. The characteristic harmonics of a 12-pulse would be 11, 13, 23, 25. Okay? So that's how you apply this special case. So In table 10.3, we list harmonic current limits based on size of load. Remember, everything is how you compare the size of your load or your plant with respect to the stiffness of the grid. We do that by calculating the short circuit versus load ratio, ISC over IL. Ratio of maximum short circuit current, which, in my opinion, should be the momentary short circuit calculation defined in the ANSI standards. And you divide it by the available current for the load at the point of common coupling, which is the maximum fundamental load current, that whole previous 12 months, 15 or 30 minute demand value. So, I said that already, the top item. Thus, you know, as your load goes up, you can't draw as much harmonic current. As your load decreases over a long period of time, you should be allowed to inject more harmonic current into a system of a given stiffness. So this protects other users on the same feeder as well as the utility. The utility is required to furnish a certain quality of voltage, and the way we can achieve that is by spreading out who can inject certain amounts of harmonics into the grid. If you're really big, percentage-wise, you can't put as much out. If you're really, really small, percentage-wise, you can put more out. So here are the tables. I'm not going to really go into detail on these, except to note this item right here. Even harmonics are limited to 25% of the odd harmonic limits above. And we take care of that in the EasyPower software. We have a separate row for the even harmonics. Also, note that as the stiffness of the grid versus your size goes up, you can inject more. So if you're on a really stiff grid, you can inject more harmonic current. If you're on a really weak portion of the grid, you're going to be limited more in what you can inject because the voltage distortion will go up as the grid stiffness goes down. All right, so that's the first table is 120, right up here, 120 to 69 kV. The next table is 69 to 161, and then we have greater than 161 kV. So those are the three main tables for the current limits. Now, how do we apply this in the IEEE 519 standard? Okay, first, select your PCC. That is the location where you connect and have a common point with other people that share. Okay? Make sure you have a switch or a breaker there in the EasyPower case. Determine the KVA load for your facility according to the 519 rules. Then calculate from that I load. Calculate the maximum short circuit current, ISC. And then calculate that ratio. Once you've done those, then you double-click on the switch or breaker that defines your PCC. Now, you'll be opening up the equipment dialog and click on the harmonics tab for that breaker or switch and check the box that says monitor IEEE 519 point of common coupling. Then enter the KVA demand of your load according to the 519 definition we talked about and enter the ratio of I short circuit over I load. If you want to see the report, then you have to enable it. So go to the harmonics report in the harmonics options and select the IEEE 519 report. And I'm going to show you all this. Okay, so let's turn this off and let's bring our EasyPower case up. So here we have a utility substation coming off a 230 kV, and I've got an infinite bus up here. That just means it's really stiff, but the main short circuit is limited by the transformer. It's a 10 MVA unit in the substation, and it has feeder. And on that feeder, I have four plants, okay? I have my plant over here on the left. I'm at the end of the feeder. And then I have other plant one and two and a really big plant tacked onto the end. Now, notice at this switch here, I've defined as my PCC, which is on the 12 kV side, not on the low voltage side. It's on the high voltage side where I have a common connection with other plants. That would be here on the 12 kV side. So if you double click on the switch, you go to the harmonics tab, you will see the checkbox. I've checked monitor IEEE 519 point of common coupling, the KVA demand, and the I short circuit over I load ratio. Now, if your power flow case has, you know, the maximum load conditions for each of these facilities in it, all you have to do is go to power flow. And notice I put loads in here for each of these facilities. Go to the power flow, solve the case, go to power flow options, and under one line output, make sure branch flows are KVA and power factor. Hit the OK button, and right here we have the KVA. And if I put in the maximum load down here in my facilities, then I should get the maximum demand up here. I've done this for you for each one of these, okay? And I've put it into an Excel spreadsheet. And I put the base KV, which is 12 KV. I put the KVA demand here, which is 1470. Yep, see that right there? 1470, and then the next one is 1852. And I type those in. And then I calculated the load amps by this number. See, if I hit F2, it'll tell me. It takes this number, 1470, the KVA, divides by KV line to line, which is this number, and by the square root of 3. And I get 70 amps. Now, the short circuit current, if you've got a case like this defined, okay, then you can get it right from the short circuit analysis. So you go to short circuit, and you do a fault all, and you'll see that the current contribution for the momentary current, phase A, and I'm looking at amps, is 2396, 3228, etc. All right, for each one of these feeds into these facilities. That's the short circuit. So again, now let's go back to my spreadsheet. And you can see that I entered those values here. All I do then is take the ratio between this, and I get the I short circuit over I load ratio. And I entered those numbers into the switch or breaker. And you can see that here. If we go to database, double click on the switch, you can see here it is, the value of 34. So that's how I calculate the KVA demand and the I short circuit over I load. Now, if you don't have a power flow case, then go off or a power flow case that matches your maximum demand for your facility over the last 12 months. You can pull that from your billing information, okay? But you'll need some short circuit contribution from the utility or some, or have simulated it yourself to be able to get the I short circuit over I load value. Now that we have that in there, let's make sure we got some loads. Okay, I built a case that has harmonics injections here. So I go to the harmonics tab for the load, and I used rectifiers of 6 pulse 0DD, which is a straight 6 pulse rectifier, and not an IGBT drive or anything, just the old 6 pulse style, which is what the characteristic would be at maximum load. And I put those numbers in. I brought them in from the library. You could use 6 pulse 0YY as well to give you the same numbers. I ignored current angle. I wasn't doing anything with phase shifts or anything with multi-pulse rectifiers. Just very simple, 0 degrees on all the current angles. So I've put harmonic loads in here for each one of these plants. All right? And if I go to harmonics, and if I click on, well, what I want to do here, I want to open these breakers because I want to know first, what's the distortion on this feeder with me by myself? If I click on the summation button, I see, boy, you know, things are pretty good. My distortion in my plant is 3.218. That's great. The voltage distortion, the bus voltage distortion on each of the buses is 1.2, dropping down to 0.6 at the main utility. Now, what about the report? Because I've got it enabled. Now let's take a look at it. Of course, this big plant's offline, so everything is zero. Let's not concern ourselves till we get to my PCC. Here we go. So I'm meeting all the current distortion limits. I'm good. I'm meeting all the limits. And because I'm the only one on the feeder, the voltage distortion, the max individual, is way below the 3%, and THD is way below 5. So we're all good here. Well, we feel everything's good. Well, a year later, this other plant comes online. All right. That's not necessarily good. Okay, so this plant came online. My voltage distortion jumped from 3.2 to 5%. All right. So things are a little worse in my facility. I'm right on the borderline. I think I could still live with 5%. I think I'm good. But it still is upsetting to me that my voltage distortion went up because of another plant. Now, you look at the other plant. Remember, we have a PCC defined up here. You look at the report. Here's my PCC. Everything's good, even from the utility perspective and from my perspective. This guy is right on the border, right on the borderline with ITDD, total demand distortion, just barely over. Most of us would probably say that that's good enough concerning how accurate or really inaccurate our estimates of what distortion numbers are. We'd probably say that that's just within, and so that's fine. Okay? So both plants are doing okay, but still the voltage distortion went up in my facility. That did not make me happy. This guy's bus voltage distortion is above 5%. Depending on who he is, he may or he may not be concerned. He just may let it go. Okay, so let's say this guy just let this go and he didn't put any filtration in. Now let's say this next plant came online. Okay, things are getting worse. Now, with this guy online injecting his harmonic content, his voltage distortion is okay, but mine is starting to reach 6%. Not necessarily happy with that, okay? Each plant that comes online, since I'm the one at the end of the feeder, I'm basically inheriting everybody else's distortion issue, okay? He's fine, but I'm not. I'm starting to get disgruntled because of the distortion condition. But if I notice on the report, everybody's within their limits. Nothing's red except for this one. Red shows there's a problem. You're violating a limit. But this guy's so close, it really is within, we could say. So with everything okay, I'm starting to get high distortion conditions in my facility. Very interesting. What would happen if the big plant at the end of the feeder finally came online? Well, now we see we are really in a undesirable condition. Even though this guy's letting it go to 11, if he were to let it go that high, everybody's voltage distortion is way over the 5% level, and mine is just over 9. That's really not a good condition to be in. You might start to see all types of interesting issues, and you know, we haven't even looked at things like transformer heating yet. But definitely, voltage distortion on the feeder has gone above acceptable levels, and we'll see that here in the 519 report. PCC big, he's the big violator. His individual harmonic, the fifth, I'll guarantee you, is greater than 7% limit, and the total demand distortion is 4% over. All right, THD on voltage, he's a percent, 1.2% over 5, and at the end of the feeder, for me, over by 2.3% on voltage distortion. Notice, I'm still within my limits. I'm doing great, but I've inherited somebody else's problem that they're creating on the utility. Remember, we're all together on the grid. We're all interconnected. We're all in each other's back pockets. There is no, you can't divorce from one another off the grid. Whatever someone causes on the grid, we all inherit. All right, look at the other plant. He's still right within his limit, but his voltage distortion is high. So the last big plant that we put on really kind of caused a bit of havoc on the whole distribution feeder. And that has to be dealt with. So more than likely, the utility, of course, I would think in most cases, would probably not have too much concern with the first three plants coming online. Hey, the voltage distortion is below 5%. Max individuals below 3. We're all good, you know, everything's fine. I don't have to go run around and check everybody's current injections. As soon as the voltage distortion gets too high, they're going to start looking. All right, so here we come along. Utility says, hey, who's causing this problem? The biggest violator is who? The big plant at the end, violating an individual and the maximum total demand distortion. So they work together. They shake hands over a way to solve and filter this system. Maybe the utility helps with the design, or maybe they help with pay for part of it, who knows, or maybe they just say, hey, you know, it's really your responsibility to do this. get your harmonics under control in your system. Utility has the authority to do that because by the standard, they have to supply the quality of voltage, and this plant is causing the major violation. If this plant were to design a fifth harmonic filter and install it and switched it on, they'd help their own voltage distortion and everybody else's all the way down. Notice this was up at 9, now it's dropped to 7. Now, okay, one plant fixed its problem, but we still are over. Look at this, is over 5% THD right on the feeder, and we'll see that here. The big plant is fine right next to the substation, but you go down the feeder, at the end of the feeder, it's 5.3%. It's still over the 5% THD, so the utility will probably go looking for the next person and saying, hey, you know, you here, plant number, I think it's plant 1 or 2, let's see which one it is. Oh, other PCC1, you're right on the borderline. Let's get this filtered and taken care of, and let's see how we solve the distortion problem on the feeder. We add some harmonic filtration, and wow, conditions are really getting good. Everybody's near the 5% limit. Even myself, my voltage distortion has dropped because of other plant 1 adding harmonic filtration. And look at all the voltage THDs. I bet you if you looked, no red. Yep, no red. So that means everyone's within limits here in the IEEE 519 reports. Everyone's within their limit, except I'm just not happy with 5.8%. I really want a cleaner bus voltage. I may have some sensitive loads. I throw on harmonic distortion for myself, or excuse me, harmonic filtering for myself, and the distortion drops to 2.6% on my bus, 3.8, 4.8, 5.6 here. Right on, this is just fine, 5.6%. And here we see again, in the 519 reports, everybody's good. No red highlights. All right, and the feeder has dropped way low, down 2-3% on its voltage THD. Okay, well, this was our webinar for today, and we looked at the 519 standard. We looked at a lot of items and how it's actually applied, and we read content right out of it. And I thought that was really important to do. You know, I can talk about it and say all I want, but when I make a real strong statement about what the PCC is, or if I make a real strong statement about the how you're supposed to apply the 519 within its scope and its application according to the text in the standard, I thought it was really important just to read it, because it really speaks for itself. There's really no reason for me to speak for the standard. I tell you, I can help, you know, help you look at systems and how to model them and how to put them in here. But it really, if you just read the text of the standard and you take it all together and don't just pull out individual sections, you'll find that it really speaks loud itself in how to apply it to the consumer utility interface on interconnected power systems. And finally, we just had a quick example here showing how multiple plants hanging off of a distribution feeder, that even when everything looks okay, you can still have an in-plant distortion issue. And likewise, even though you're meeting all the IEEE 519 limits for the current injections, you can still have a voltage violation because you're not diverse. Remember, there's diversity in the standard. And if you're not diverse and everybody's putting in all that harmonic injection at the same time, you'll find times where the voltage distortion on that distribution feeder at the PCCs will go above the limits, even though all of the consumers are below theirs. Okay, well, thank you, everyone, for attending today. And I will stay on for a few more minutes after this, you know, for about 10 minutes to chat with anybody who might have questions on the content today. And I really thank you for attending and hope you have a good rest of your week. Goodbye.